Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This is Pastor Raziel McFall, citizen of the Kingdom of God and ambassador of Christ. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, God said, "Let us make man in our image and after our likeness, and let them have dominion." My fellow believer, this was God's primary motivation and purpose for creating man. In the beginning, our God gave mankind a kingdom and not a religion. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, Jesus outlines what should be the priorities of man. Every man should busy himself seeking God's kingdom and his righteousness. If the church is to be delivered from the limitations of this world and begin to experience the victory and abundant life that Jesus came to make available to us, we must become more knowledgeable about the kingdom of God and commit ourselves to walking in his righteousness. As you listen to the following message, it is our prayer that you receive insight into God's kingdom and be delivered from the spirit of religion that has held God's people captive for generations. God bless and strengthen you as you listen to the word of God.
Let the kings worship him today. Let the kings worship him.
As you can see, our overall topic continues to be the kingdom of God. For indeed, Christ Jesus declared that he must preach the kingdom of God to other cities also, for that's why he was sent. And indeed, he encouraged us and he commanded us to seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. And he promised that everything that we need will be added to us. And so we bless the Lord. And in obedience to Christ Jesus, we continue to seek the kingdom of God. And as you can see, our subtopic tonight is understanding the kingdom of God. This is part two of the lesson that we started last week. We bless the Lord because we believe that this is a very important message for the people of God to understand. And so we're taking our time and trying to convey this important message to the people of God. Before we get started tonight, I just want to share a word that the Lord has been impressing upon my heart this week. And we want to start in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 3 to 6, just for a few moments. Paul the Apostle says, "But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost." Look at what he says in verse 4 of 2 Corinthians 4. He says, "In whom the God of this world had blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them." Whenever the Bible speaks about the blinding of minds, it is speaking about people being kept in the dark or people being kept in ignorance. And so we see that the Bible speaks here about the God of this world, who we know is Satan the devil, blinding the minds of them which believe not, not having them to receive the light of the word of God, the knowledge of God's forgiveness and his love and everything else that's available to the people of God through Jesus Christ in God's kingdom. Here it is in verse 5 of 2 Corinthians 4. Paul says, "For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake." Look at verse 6 of 2 Corinthians 4. Paul says, "For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to do what? To give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ." Notice Paul says that it's God's will to give us the light of the knowledge. I want you to see the connection between light and knowledge, my brother and my sister. Here's the word that the Lord has been speaking to my heart this week. Why does God want to give us the light of knowledge? Will he let me know that the enemy thrives in darkness or ignorance? Darkness or ignorance, my brother, actually gives the enemy power. Ignorance gives the enemy power in your life, which leads to destruction and bondage. This is why Hosea says, "My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge." God said through the prophet Isaiah that his people had gone into captivity because they have no knowledge. And so the Lord is saying to us that the enemy thrives in darkness. Darkness is what gives the enemy power and authority over our lives. He wants us to know that the more knowledge or light we receive, the more of our lives will be recovered from the kingdom of darkness. and the less authority and control the enemy will have over us. Remember, we were all born in the kingdom of darkness. And so, unfortunately, there are some lingering cultural influences from that kingdom that are still in our lives. But the more we receive knowledge and revelation and wisdom, the Lord is saying that more and more of our lives will be recovered from the kingdom of darkness, and the less authority and control the enemy will have over us. Remember what Paul the Apostle says to the saints here in Colossians 1, 12 to 13. Paul says in verse 12, giving thanks unto the Father, which had made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. Look at verse 13. Paul says, who hath, that's past tense, delivered us from the power. That power there is the Greek word exousia, which is authority, control, influence, and force. And so the Bible says that God has delivered us from the power, from the authority, control, influence, and force of darkness, and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. My brother and my sister, a simple word of encouragement to you. Let's follow after light and knowledge and eliminate the influence or power of the kingdom of darkness from off our lives. What we say, my brother and my sister, the Lord has been saying is that ignorance and darkness is where the enemy thrives. This is what gives him power and authority. But when you understand that you have authority and power from the kingdom of God, and God gives light and wisdom and understanding and revelation, the less power and authority the enemy will have over your life. But last week we began a detailed study of the kingdom of God with a view to helping the people of God understand this grace wherein they now stand. The idea is to let God's people know that when they were born again, they did not enter a religion, but they became God's children and voluntarily and willingly aligned themselves with God's kingdom government, which gave them immediate access to all available and related rights, privileges, benefits, power, and authority of the kingdom of heaven. We learned that man created religion because they failed to properly discern God's original intent. And so man was not clear of what God was doing in the beginning, and so he went ahead to create religion as a means to seek to get God's attention. But we also said last week that kingdom-minded people seek to understand God's intention and seek to fulfill his will and his purpose in the earth. We learned that when God made man and gave him dominion over the earth, our God established government and not religion. God said, let us make man, let them have dominion. And so God was putting in place the government for the colony that he had established on the earth. So after creating him and his image and his likeness, the first thing that God gave man was dominion. From God's perspective, dominating the earth and ensuring that it remained under God's kingdom government was and continues to be the official function of mankind. Here's a quote from a book called Reclaiming God's Original Purpose for Your Life by Dr. Miles E. Monroe. Dr. Monroe says, God created human beings specifically for the purpose of dominating the earth for him and filling it with his nature, character, and culture. We said that one of the learning objectives of this overall lesson is to receive a better understanding of God's big idea for mankind and the earth. So what was God's overall plan and God's big idea? Well, here's another quote from Reclaiming God's Original Purpose for Your Life by Dr. Monroe. He says that God's big idea was to reproduce the kingdom of heaven in the visible realm by planting a kingdom outpost on the earth and populating it with kingdom citizens who would govern according to kingdom government, live according to kingdom culture, and expand kingdom influence until it filled and transformed the earth. Remember, God told Adam and Eve to be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth with people who also reflected the image and likeness of God like God made them in the beginning. Last week, we discussed God's original kingdom and outlined what God's kingdom looked like in the beginning. Here's what we said God's kingdom looked like in the beginning. God's kingdom was comprised of heaven, which is the supernatural invisible realm called his throne, where God exercised and continues to exercise direct rulership. when he created man and gave him dominion on the earth was part of God's kingdom, and so his kingdom was also comprised of the earth, which is the natural visible realm called his footstool, where God exercised indirect rulership through man, supported by his Holy Spirit that he had breathed on the inside of man. Last week, we also learned what the relationship between these two parts of God's kingdom was called. We learned that they were called an imperial power and a colony. The imperial power is the home country where the king or queen lives and reigns from, and the colony is the outpost or foreign territory that comes under the government of the imperial power. We said that because God extended his government, influence, and authority to the foreign territory of the earth, this process is called colonization, and the earth became a colony of heaven. So in this relationship, heaven is the imperial power, and earth was the colony. Last week, we also learned that there are four conditions that must be current in order for a true imperial power-colony relationship to exist. Here they are. We have them on a single slide. We said that the king or leader of the imperial power must own the land and everything in the foreign territory. We know that it continues to be the case according to Psalm 24, verses 1 and 2. The second condition that must exist, the people of that foreign territory must be citizens of the imperial power. The third condition, that foreign territory must be impacted and influenced by the culture of the imperial power. And the will, purpose, and intent of the king must prevail, not only in the home territory or the imperial power, but also in the colony or the outpost. And finally, an official representative of or from the kingdom or imperial power must be resident in the foreign territory. We learned that after Adam and Eve, as rulers of the earth, disobeyed God, they committed treason and declared independence from God and from his kingdom. After Adam and Eve sinned, conditions 2, 3, and 4 no longer existed. And therefore, the imperial power colony relationship between heaven and earth and God and man fell apart. Again, we said these are the three things that Christ Jesus came to remedy. Christ Jesus, through the power of his blood and through faith in that blood, came to make it possible for us to again be citizens of God's kingdom. And because of the cleansing power of the blood of Jesus, our bodies would qualify for Holy Spirit, who is the official representative from the imperial power, to be restored to us. And because Holy Spirit would be on the inside of us, we would be empowered to cause the influence and the culture of the imperial power and the will, purpose, and intent of the king to be manifested in our lives. And so numbers 2, 3, and 4 are the very things that Christ Jesus came to remedy. And so because those conditions no longer existed, the earth was no longer part of God's kingdom. When Adam and Eve sinned, we said that this is what happened. Mankind essentially lowered the flag of the kingdom of God or the kingdom of light, and they raised the flag of the kingdom of Satan or the kingdom of darkness. Adam and Eve, representing all mankind, were no longer citizens of God's kingdom. What they did was they instead became citizens of the kingdom of the devil or the kingdom of darkness. The earth was no longer part of God's kingdom, my brother and my sister, after Adam and Eve's rebellion. Adam and Eve turned the government of God's kingdom over to the devil. Now, as a result of man's declaration of independence, we said that something else happened. We said that the royal governor from heaven, who was God's Holy Spirit, who represented the king and ensured that his will was being done on the earth, also left his house, which was man's body. Again, we said in the Bahamas, the former royal governor would live in a big pink house on Duke Street, but God's Holy Spirit lived in mankind, and so our body was the temple of the Lord. And so because Adam and Eve, representing mankind, declared independence, Holy Spirit had to be recalled. Throughout the Old Testament, Holy Spirit never entered anyone. He would rest upon either the prophet, the priest, or the king. And so God was get his will done by having the Spirit of God rest upon one of these individuals. But Holy Spirit never dwelled within anyone. And so God's will was being done that way. But again, we said the earth no longer looked like heaven because Holy Spirit, who was empowering mankind to reflect the image and likeness of God and his morals and his values and his standards and his lifestyle and his character and his nature and his image and his likeness, left. And so again, we say that the imperial power relationship between heaven and earth was completely destroyed. The earth, we say, was no longer under God's government and was therefore no longer part of God's kingdom. We learned that after Adam and Eve rebelled, this is what the custody of the kingdom looked like. Indeed, we said when God made heaven and earth, God governed and ruled both heaven and earth directly. But God made a decision to give man dominion, and so what he did was he transferred the custody of the kingdom to mankind. When Adam and Eve sinned and rebelled against God, what they did was they abdicated their throne, and they were deposed, and they were removed from their position of authority. And the devil became the god of this world. And so this is where we left off last week. We said that this was the position of the custody of the kingdom after Adam and Eve rebelled and turned God's kingdom over to the devil. Now, ever since Adam and Eve conveyed God's kingdom on the earth to the devil, God was on a mission to get his kingdom back. No king who has the power would allow someone else to take their kingdom or their territory, take their domain or their dominion, and would not seek to have their kingdom or their dominion restored. What we said, my brother and my sister, is that our God's highest priority is the reestablishment of his kingdom on the earth. This is God's highest priority, the reestablishment of his kingdom on the earth. This is why God sent his son, Christ Jesus, to the earth. Remember, Jesus came declaring, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Jesus came to reestablish God's kingdom on the earth and to make it possible for those who accepted his plan of salvation to again be brought under God's kingdom government. Jesus said something that is widely misunderstood in the church. Here it is in Luke chapter 19, verse 10. Jesus says, "For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost." What does this word save mean? Notice he said he came to seek and to save. This word save is the Greek word sozo, spelt S-O-Z-O. It means to deliver. It means to make whole. It means to get. It means to preserve. And most importantly, it means to recover and to restore. Just let us say right here that all of our Greek and Hebrew definitions are taken from the Strong's Concordance with Greek and Hebrew dictionary. And so Christ Jesus says that he came to seek and to save. He came to recover. He came to make whole. He came to get. He came to restore that which was lost. My brother and my sister, that which was lost was not only mankind, but from God's perspective, and more importantly, that which was lost was God's kingdom. This is what Christ Jesus came to recover and to restore, the kingdom of God on the earth. Jesus came to get his Father's kingdom back, and by so doing, restore the governmental order that God established in the beginning, which included man exercising dominion on the earth under God's delegated authority. Now, for a few bites of a fruit, man surrendered and forfeited his access to two primary things. Remember, God told Adam that if they eat of that tree in the midst of the garden, they would surely die. But they could not overcome the power and the temptation of the enemy, and they partook of that tree. And so for a few bites of a fruit, man surrendered and forfeited his access to two primary things. He surrendered and forfeited his access to the dominion assignment or mandate that God gave him. And he also forfeited and gave up his kingdom citizenship, which was connected to his sonship. Mankind rejected God, and their relationship with their father and their king was destroyed. Man and the spirit gave up their passports to the kingdom of light, and they accepted passports from the kingdom of darkness. For this reason, mankind lost the access to the king and kingdom of heaven that they previously enjoyed. Remember, God walked and talked with them in the cool of the day, and so they had access, free and unfettered access to the spirit realm, to their God and their father and their king. Well, I thank God that despite Adam and Eve's rebellion, our God did not give up on mankind, and he declared his plan of redemption immediately after Adam and Eve sinned. Here's what happened in Genesis chapter 3, verses 14 to 15. The Bible says, "And the Lord said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle and above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life." And so God was dealing with each and every one of them. He started with the woman, then he went to the man, and now he's dealing with the serpent whose body was commandeered by the devil. Now notice that God was speaking here to a serpent that allowed the devil to use his body. We'll see the significance of that a little later in this lesson. He's speaking to a serpent, but God continued to outline the consequences for this devil's action. Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. God says, "And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed, and it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel." Notice we have the word "his" underlined. The seed of the woman was therefore a man who would be born in the future. The seed of the woman was coming to bruise the head of the snake and the devil. Let's take a closer look at these two words. We know we love to dig and dive deep into the Word of God. We want to take a closer look at the words "bruise" and the word "head." The word "bruise" is the Hebrew word "shuf," spelled S-H-U-W-P-H. It means to gape, as in make a gaping hole. It means to snap at. It means to overwhelm, and it means to break. So we had two words. We had "bruise" and we had "head." What is the word "head"? The word "head" is the Hebrew word "roshe," spelled R-O-S-H. What does it mean? It means place, rank, highest part, top, forefront position, principal, and ruler. So with our understanding of the meanings of these two words, what exactly was God saying to the serpent and the devil that commandeered his body? God was saying that a seed of the woman was going to defeat and overwhelm you and destroy your authority and remove you from the top position, place, and rank you stole through deception, and reestablish my kingdom and government on the earth. My brother and my sister, this was the first glimpse of the Redeemer and Restorer, Christ Jesus, in the Bible. Now, in the process of time, God determined that this seed would come through the lineage of a faithful man named Abraham, and then down through the lineage of another friend of God, who was King David. These are, in fact, the only two names that appear with the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in the very first verse of the New Testament. God spoke to both of these two great friends of his about the seed. Remember, he said that the seed of this woman was coming to bruise the devil's head. And so he began to speak to these two chosen individuals about the seed. Firstly, here's God's promise to Abraham after he was willing to obey him and sacrifice his son Isaac. In Genesis chapter 22, verses 16 to 18, God said, "By myself have I sworn, saith the Lord, for because thou hast done this thing and hast not withheld thy son, thine only son," verse 17 of Genesis 22, "that in blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying I will multiply thy seed as the stars of the heaven and as the sand which is upon the seashore, and thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemies." Notice what he says, "thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemies." Look at verse 18 of Genesis 22. He said, "And in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because thou hast obeyed my voice." Remember, God said the seed of the woman was going to bruise the devil and the serpent's head. And God is saying here that in the seed of Father Abraham, all the nations of the earth shall be blessed. God just told Abraham that his seed was going to possess the gate of his enemy. I believe that when we look at this scripture, we might think that God is speaking about all of the descendants of Father Abraham. But Paul the Apostle explained the relationship between this promise to Father Abraham and Christ. He explained to us that this seed was actually Christ Jesus and not all of the descendants of Father Abraham. Here it is in Galatians chapter 3, verse 16. Paul says, now to Abraham and to his seed were the promises made. He saith not unto seeds as of many, but as of one, unto thy seed, which is Christ. And so God was saying, through thy seed, through Christ Jesus, shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. This is the seed that was coming to bruise that enemy's head, to remove him from that position of authority that he stole through deception of Adam and Eve. The seed through whom the nations of the earth would be blessed, my brother and my sister, was therefore not all of the descendants of Father Abraham, but one specific seed, who was Christ Jesus. Then secondly, God spoke to his other friend, King David, about this seed again. Here it is in 1 Chronicles 17 and 11. God said to the prophet Nathan, and it shall come to pass when thy days be expired, that thou must go to be with thy fathers, that I will raise up thy seed after thee, which shall be of thy sons, and I will establish his kingdom. God spoke to Father Abraham about this seed. Now he's speaking about King David, about this seed, my brother and my sister. This was the seed that was coming to bruise the devil's head. The seed that God referred to in his promises to Father Abraham and King David was the same seed that was coming to remove the devil from his position of authority. We note that this restoration of God's kingdom was to be accomplished through the seed of a woman. The question is, why couldn't God just do this without using the seed of a woman or using mankind? Why could not God simply restore the kingdom without using flesh and blood or without using mankind? Well, the answer lies in what God said when he created man in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. This is the first part. The Bible says, and God said, let us make man in our image and after our likeness, and let them have dominion. Notice, God said, let us make man, but let them have dominion. He did not say, let us have dominion. In the beginning, God gave mankind dominion of the earth. This was an irrevocable decree and law established by God in the beginning, my brother and my sister. Therefore, to remain in compliance with his own laws, in order to exercise dominion on the earth, God himself had to become flesh to operate lawfully and legally in the earth. Here's what John says in St. John chapter 1, verse 14. The Bible says, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. My brother and my sister, the Word had to become flesh because God gave flesh dominion on the earth. This also explains why Christ Jesus said what he did as he began his prayer just prior to his arrest and crucifixion. Here it is in St. John chapter 17, verses 1 to 2. This was quickened in my spirit as I was listening to this scripture earlier today. St. John chapter 17, verse 1 says, Father, the hour is come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee. Look at what Jesus says in verse 2 of John 17. As thou hast given him power, that's exousia, authority and influence, over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. And so God had to give Christ Jesus authority, power, and influence over all flesh, so that Christ Jesus could come down and exercise this dominion in the earth realm, because in Genesis 1:26, God says, let man have dominion, and so the Word had to become flesh so that Christ Jesus could come and exercise the dominion and the authority that God gave him. Paul, who's believed to be the author of the book of Hebrews, spoke about the preparation of a body for the Word to operate lawfully and legally on the earth. Here it is in Hebrews chapter 10, verses 4 to 5. Paul says, for it is not possible that the blood of bulls and of goats should take away sins. So because man transgressed and rebelled, the blood of man had to redeem and cleanse mankind and restore and reconcile him to God. Here it is in verse 5 of Hebrews 10. Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he saith, sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a body hast thou prepared me. And so the Word became flesh, and a body was prepared for the Word, so that the Word could exercise the dominion and come down and defeat that devil and restore and reconcile man to God and begin the process of reestablishing God's kingdom on the earth. Here's Paul again in Hebrews chapter 2, verses 14 to 17. Paul says, "For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same. And so because the children are flesh and blood, God, through his son Christ Jesus, had to also take part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil." Look at verses 15 and 16 of Hebrews 2. "And deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage." Look at what it says in verse 16. "For verily he took not on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham." Remember now, the promise of this seed came originally through Father Abraham. And so even God himself through Christ Jesus had to become flesh so that he could become this seed that God promised that devil was coming to bruise his head. Here it is in verse 17 of Hebrews 2. "Wherefore, in all things it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in the things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people." Notice the Bible said it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren. This word behooved is a very powerful and pivotal word. Here's what it means. The word behooved is the Greek word ophelo. That's O-P-H-E-I-L-O. Look at what it means. It means to owe. It means to be bound, must needs. And most importantly, it means to be under obligation. My brother and my sister, God himself was bound by his royal decree and was under obligation to become flesh, to operate legally under the dominion he gave to mankind in the beginning. Paul provided more details of the need for the word to be made flesh in his first letter to the Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 21 to 22. Paul says, "For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive." Here's Paul again to the church at Rome, Romans chapter 5, verses 17 to 19. Paul says in verse 17, "For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ." Notice God expects for us to reign in life, not in death, my brother and my sister. Verse 18 says, "Therefore, as by the offense of one judgment came upon all men to condemnation, even so by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life." Verse 19 of Romans 5, "For as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous." Death came by man, so life also had to come by man. And so in the fullness of time, that's exactly what God did. He sent his son in the form of a man. Paul tells us this here in Galatians chapter 4, verses 4 to 5. The Bible says, "But when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his son made of a woman, made under the law." It was absolutely necessary for the word to become flesh so that he could be faithful to and operate under God's decree, and so that he could exercise dominion on the earth and overcome that devil and restore God's kingdom government on the earth, my brother and my sister. Verse 5 lets us know part of the reason why Christ came. Here it is in Galatians 4 and 5, "To redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons." The Son of God came to restore man's ability to become sons of God again, my brother and my sister. The promise that the seed of this woman was coming to bruise the devil or the serpent's head was made all the way in the Garden of Eden. But what does the Bible say about the timing, or when was this seed supposed to come to reestablish God's kingdom on the earth? What is the fullness of time that we just saw Paul the Apostle speak about to the church at Galatia? Well, Daniel actually lets us know as he revealed and interpreted Nebuchadnezzar's dream. You will recall in Daniel chapter 2 that Nebuchadnezzar had a dream that he forgot. And what he did was he called all his Chaldeans and soothsayers and his magicians and told them that if they did not tell him his dream and the interpretation, their heads would be cut off and their homes would be made a downhill, but he would bless them and they would receive great honor and riches from him if they were able to tell him both his dream and interpret the dream. Indeed, only the God of heaven was able to reveal this dream to Daniel. And so we see here that Nebuchadnezzar saw this great image as Daniel related in Daniel chapter 2. The image that Nebuchadnezzar saw had a head of gold. It also had chest and arms of silver, belly and thighs of bronze or brass. It had legs of iron. It had feet of iron and clay. And according to Daniel's interpretation of Nebuchadnezzar's dream, a rock or stone that was cut out without hands also appeared. And what this stone did, it struck the image upon its feet that were iron of clay. And it totally destroyed the clay and the iron and the brass and the silver and the gold. And the Bible says that they became as chaff and they were whisked away by the wind. And this rock became a great and mighty mountain and it filled the entire earth. And so in providing the interpretation of Nebuchadnezzar's dream, Daniel discussed the government that would be in place when the kingdom of God was to be reestablished on the earth. This crushing rock, my brother and my sister, was the kingdom of God. Here's what Daniel says in Daniel chapter 2, verses 41 to 44. Daniel says, "And whereas thou sawest the feet and toes, part of potter's clay and part of iron, the kingdom shall be divided. But there shall be in it of the strength of the iron, for as much as thou sawest the iron mixed with miry clay." Verse 42 of Daniel 2. He says, "And as the toes of the feet were part of iron and part of clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly broken." Verse 43, he says, "And whereas thou sawest iron mixed with miry clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men, but they shall not cleave one to another, even as iron is not mixed with clay." Here it is in Daniel 2:44. He says, "And in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. And the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever," my brother and my sister. This is the rock that Daniel saw that was cut out without hands, that totally destroyed the image, and it became a great and mighty mountain, and it filled the entire earth. This is the kingdom of God that shall never be destroyed. This kingdom was to be established in the days of these kings, or when this particular form of government and rulership prevailed on the earth. So Daniel's interpretation of Nebuchadnezzar's dream outlined the various kingdoms and government that would dominate the earth in sequence. Here's a summary of what Daniel declared that Nebuchadnezzar saw in his vision. As we said, Nebuchadnezzar saw a head of gold, which was Nebuchadnezzar himself and Babylon. The chest and the arms of silver were the Medes and the Persians, who dominated the earth after they defeated Nebuchadnezzar's son Belshazzar. Then the image also had a belly and thighs of brass. This was the Grecian kingdom headed by Alexander the Great. He said that the image had legs of iron. This was Rome. But he also said that the image would have feet of iron and clay. And so when the government was comprised of this iron and this clay, Daniel says that this kingdom, this rock that was cut out without hand, would appear. And so this was the form of government that would exercise power and dominion on the earth when the kingdom of God was about to appear. God was to begin to set up his kingdom when the entity that governed Israel was comprised of iron and clay. One day I was reading the book of Luke, and the Lord said to me, "There's the iron and the clay." It was a description of the government that existed when Christ came on the scene declaring that the kingdom of heaven had arrived on the earth. Here it is, Luke chapter 3, verses 1 to 2. The Bible says, "Now in the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate being governor of Judea, and Herod being tetrarch of Galilee, and his brother Philip tetrarch of Iturea, and of the region of Trachonitis, and Licinius the tetrarch of Abilene." Now, Rome was separated into four sections, and what Tiberius Caesar did was he placed the governor over those four sections of Rome. They were called tetrarchs. They all reported to the emperor, or the king, Tiberius Caesar. But the Bible spoke about iron and clay. This was the description of the iron, but what is the clay? The very next verse describes the clay, as the Lord began to reveal it to me. Luke chapter 3, verse 2. it says Annas and Caiaphas being the high priest. This is the claim, my brother and my sister, the religious leaders of Israel. Remember, God's people were called clay by both Isaiah and Jeremiah. Here's Isaiah in Isaiah 64 and 8. But now, O Lord, thou art our Father. We are the clay, and thou art our potter, and we all are the work of thy hand. Here's Jeremiah calling the children of Israel clay. Jeremiah chapter 18, verse 6. He says, O house of Israel, cannot I do with you as this potter, said the Lord? Behold, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are ye in mine hand, O house of Israel. So clay represents the house of Israel. But remember, Daniel described this clay. Here it is in Daniel chapter 2, verse 43. He says, and whereas thou sawest the iron mixed with miry clay. This was not just any kind of clay. This was miry clay. They shall mingle themselves with the seed of men. And so I was able to do some research on this word miry. This is not just clay. It was miry clay. Here's what I found from dictionary.com. There are some related words that relate to miry. It's not very good words. Mucky, scummy, yucky, and swampy. And so these are some not so good words that Daniel declared and he used to describe this clay. Then Daniel said miry clay. He was therefore referring to the contaminated clay, which refers to the religious leaders who were part of the government when Jesus came announcing the arrival of the kingdom, my brother and my sister. While the Roman government was the ultimate authority, they allowed the religious leaders to rule the people according to the laws of Moses. This is what the Bible means when it says that they would not cleave to one another. How do we know that the religious leaders were part of the government? Well, remember what happened when they took Jesus to Pilate. Here it is in St. John 18:31. Then said Pilate unto them, take ye him and judge him according to your law. The Jews therefore said unto him, it is not lawful for us to put any man to death. The religious leaders had the ability to execute judgment according to the laws of Moses. Remember, the Bible says the religious leaders had officers. Remember, they sent officers to arrest Jesus. They could beat people as they did to Peter and John in Acts chapter 5, verse 40. Remember also what happened after the Lord used the apostles to heal many people in Acts chapter 5. Acts chapter 5, verses 17 to 21. The Bible says, then the high priest rose up, and all they that were with him, which is the sect of the Sadducees, and were filled with indignation. Verse 18, and laid their hands on the apostles and put them in the common prison. Only government officials, my brother and my sister, have the ability to cause people to be put into prison. Verse 19 of Acts 5, but the angel of the Lord by night opened the prison doors and brought them forth and said, go stand and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life. Look at verse 21 of Acts 5. And when they heard that, they entered into the temple early in the morning. But the Bible says the high priest came, and they that were with him, and called the council together, and all the senate of the children of Israel, and sent to the prison to have them brought. The high priest was able to convene a governmental meeting of the council and of the senate of the children of Israel, my brother and my sister. The high priest, who delegated authority to the other religious leaders, was therefore the leader of the local government and was the leader of the clay in Daniel's interpretation of Nebuchadnezzar's dream. It makes sense because this was the form of government that prevailed when Jesus came to reestablish God's government on the earth. These contaminated religious leaders were the clay. You might also have missed this description of Brother Nicodemus, who came to Jesus by night. St. John chapter 3, verse 1. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. And so the iron was the Roman government, and the clay was the religious leaders headed by the high priest. The kingdom of God was to be established when the government was comprised of this iron and clay. And God's kingdom and government, though spiritual, was to overcome, override, and supersede all these kingdoms. This is the rock that was cut out without hands that Nebuchadnezzar saw, my brother and my sister. This is the rock that destroyed the clay and the iron and the brass and the silver and the gold. This is the rock that became a great and mighty mountain that filled the entire earth. And so God came to establish a more powerful and a more potent kingdom than those kingdoms that prevailed at the time. No wonder Isaiah says to us in Isaiah 9, 6, and 7, it says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." The Bible says in verse 7, "Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end, upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this." Brothers and sisters, Christ Jesus came to reestablish the governmental structure and the divine order that God put in place at the beginning, not to establish a religion called Christianity. Jesus came to defeat the devil so that man's sonship and his place of dominion in God's kingdom on the earth could be restored. This is why Jesus' role and function were made clear when the angel Gabriel announced his conception. Here it is in Luke chapter 1, verses 30 to 33. The Bible says, "And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God." Verse 31, "And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, and shalt call his name Jesus." Here it is in verse 32 of Luke 1. "He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord shall give unto him the throne of his father David." This was not about religion, my brother and my sister. This was about dominion. This was about a throne. This was about kingship. This was about kingdom. Here it is in verse 33 of Luke 1. "And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever." This is that dominion that shall last forever and ever and shall never be destroyed. Look at what the angel said to Mary as he concluded this salutation and this announcement. He said, "And of his kingdom there shall be no end." My brother and my sister, we all overlook this during our time in church, but Christ Jesus came to establish a kingdom, not to establish religion. And so because Jesus' mission was to reestablish God's kingdom on the earth, John the Baptist, Jesus' forerunner, and the one who came to prepare his way before him, came preaching a particular message. Here's what the Bible says in Matthew 3, 1-2. It says, "In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea." Look at verse 2, "and saying, Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Then Christ Jesus picked up the baton. Here it is in Mark 1, 14-15. "Now after that John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God." Verse 15, "and saying, The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel." We said also that Jesus declared the purpose for his coming in Luke chapter 4, verse 43. I need to keep this scripture before your face, my brother and my sister. Jesus says, "I must preach the kingdom of God to other cities also, for therefore am I sent." Jesus came to get his father's kingdom back from that devil, my brother and my sister. And so Jesus said he came to preach the kingdom of God. This is why he was sent. And so this is exactly what Christ Jesus did. Everywhere he went, he preached the kingdom of God. Matthew 9, 35. "And Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogue and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing every sickness and every disease among the people." God promised that the seed of this woman was coming to bruise the devil's head so that he would be removed from the position of authority that he stole from Adam and Eve. This is exactly what Christ Jesus came to do, my brother and my sister. He came to bruise that devil's head. He came to overwhelm him. He came to spoil his goods. He came to defeat him, my brother and my sister, so that God's kingdom could be restored on the earth. The Bible explains this in a number of scriptures. Here's one such scripture in Matthew chapter 12, verses 28 to 29. The Bible says that the Pharisees accused Jesus of casting out devils by the prince of devils. But here's what Jesus says. He says, "But if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God is come unto you." Jesus says, "If I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God is come unto you." Jesus was saying that the fact that he was able to cast out devils confirmed that a greater kingdom, the kingdom of God, had arrived on the earth. He was saying that he was demonstrating the power and the culture and the authority of this kingdom, which was able to overcome, override, supersede, and replace the prevailing culture of the kingdom of darkness, which was manifested in sickness and demon possession and lack and every evil work. Then Christ Jesus went on to confirm his mission. Here it is in Matthew 12, 29. Jesus says, or else how can one enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods except he first bind the strong man and then he will spoil his house? Christ Jesus came to defeat this strong man so that he could strip him of his goods. His goods were the power and authority to impose his will, his intent, and his culture over the lives of the people on the earth, my brother and my sister. Christ Jesus came to spoil his goods. Here's what Paul the Apostle says to the Colossians in Colossians chapter 2, verses 13 to 15. Paul says, "And you, being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened or made alive together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses." Look at what Paul says Christ Jesus did. "Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to the cross." Here it is in verse 15. "And having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a shew of them openly, triumphing over them in it." It here, my brother and my sister, is the cross of Calvary. Through Jesus' death on the cross and subsequent victorious resurrection, Christ Jesus defeated the devil, broke the power and authority of the kingdom of darkness off the life of any man who accepted his plan of salvation, and he bound that strong man so that he could spoil his goods, my brother and my sister. And so Christ Jesus came to bind that strong man so that he could strip away his goods, which we said were the authority and the power that he could exercise on the earth by virtue of Adam and Eve's rebellion. The Bible says here that he spoiled the principalities and powers. You know, I have to take a closer look at that word spoil. I went to the Oxford Dictionary and I see that the word spoil means to diminish or to destroy the value of. Dictionary.com says that spoil means to plunder, pillage, or rob. And the Merriam-Webster Dictionary says it means to damage seriously or ruin. This is what Christ Jesus came to do. He came to damage that devil and to destroy the value of all the goods that he had. He came to plunder and pillage him. He came to take away everything that he had that was valuable. He came to damage him seriously and to ruin his ability to exercise dominion and authority over the people of God that accepted God's plan of salvation. Here's what Paul the Apostle, who's believed to be the author of the book of Hebrews, says to us in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14. Paul says, "For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil." Christ Jesus' mission was to destroy that devil, my brother and my sister, to spoil him, to take away his goods, to spoil principalities and powers, to overcome and overwhelm him. This was that seed that was coming to bruise that devil's head. The Bible says through death he might destroy him. A word that we've come to love, here it is, the word destroy, is the Greek word katargeo. That's katargeo. It means to be rendered entirely idle or useless. It means to abolish, to do away with, to make to become without effect or of none effect, to bring to naught, to put down, and to make void. My brother and my sister, that devil is only as a roaring lion. What we said earlier was darkness and ignorance give the enemy power and authority. But if you understand that Christ Jesus came and he destroyed him, he rendered him entirely idle and useless, that devil no longer has power and authority over you, my brother and my sister. You are no longer a citizen of his kingdom. He no longer has any jurisdiction and power and authority over you. You are now a citizen of God's kingdom. You are now God's sons and daughters. You are now an ambassador of Christ. What else does the Bible say that Christ came to do to this devil? 1 John chapter 3, verse 8. The Bible says, "He that committed sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil." My brother and my sister, not only did Christ Jesus come to destroy the devil, but he also came to destroy the works of the devil. The works of the devil are to steal and to kill and to destroy. It includes sin and sickness and disease and lack and poverty and distress and depression and every evil or ungodly thing that you can think about. Remember, these things are simply part of the culture of the kingdom of darkness that Adam and Eve allowed to prevail on the earth through the abdication of their throne to the devil. Christ Jesus came to restore the culture of his heavenly kingdom on the earth. This is the culture of forgiveness and love and peace and power and possibilities and abundant provision. He came, my brother and my sister, that we might have life and that we might have it more abundantly. The Bible says he was manifested to destroy the works of the devil. We'll take a closer look at this word, destroy. It is the Greek word luo, that's L-U-O, which means to dissolve. It means to put off. It means to loosen. It means to melt. It also means to break up. And so Christ Jesus came to destroy, dissolve, put off, loosen, melt, and break up the works of the devil, my brother and my sister. Again, this meant reversal, removal, and replacement of the culture of the kingdom of darkness from off the lives of those who accepted God's plan of salvation. Now I understand why Jesus said what he said here in St. John chapter 12, verse 31. Jesus says, now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out. The word prince is the Greek word archon. And so Jesus is saying, listen to me now. The prince of this world is going to be cast out of his position of prince, out of his position of authority from over the lives of those that accept God's plan of salvation. He came to make it possible for the prince of this world to be cast out, my brother and my sister. What do these words cast out mean? Well, this is a very interesting word. Here's an exhaustive definition of these words cast out. They are the Greek word ekbalo. Look at what the Bible says. Jesus says, now shall the prince of this world be cast out. Now shall the prince of this world be ekbalo. Look what he said. To drive out. To send out with notion of violence. Jesus did not say, excuse me, Mr. Devil, can you please give me back my father's kingdom? The Bible said he sent him out with notion of violence. It says to cast out of the world. That is to be deprived of the power and influence exercised in the world. It means to command or cause one to depart in haste. Jesus caused that devil to depart in haste. No wonder the Bible says that if we submit ourselves to God and resist the devil, he will flee from us. It also means to draw out with force. It means to tear out with force, overcoming opposite force. And so as the devil tried to hold on to this kingdom, and he continues to do so by keeping the people of God in darkness about the kingdom of God, but Jesus came to tear him out with a force that opposes and overcomes his force. It means to reject with contempt, to lead one forth or away somewhere with a force which he cannot resist. I have to read that one again. It means to lead one forth or away somewhere with a force which he cannot resist. My brother and my sister, that devil could not resist the power and the authority of the King of Heaven who came to defeat him and to restore God's kingdom on the earth. And so because of his defeat of the enemy, Christ Jesus was able to make the following declaration just prior to his ascension. Here it is in Matthew 28 and 18. Jesus says, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth, my brother and my sister. All exousia, all dunamis, all power in heaven and in earth was given to him. Why? Because he defeated the one who exercised dominion on the earth. But the people of God just do not know that Christ Jesus has destroyed that devil and destroyed the works of the devil. And he's left us to be his salt and light and leaven. And he's empowered us by his Holy Spirit to exercise dominion and authority over that devil. It's time for us to rise up, my brother and my sister, and demonstrate kingdom power and authority. So after Jesus' victory, what did the custody of the kingdom look like? We said that the custody of the kingdom began with God. He gave mankind dominion, and so it was transferred to mankind. Mankind rebelled against God, and what he did was he transferred the custody of the kingdom to Satan the devil. What God did was God strategically, we saw that the word became flesh, and so he prepared a body for his son, and his son came down, exercised dominion on the earth by virtue of the flesh that God gave him, and he defeated that devil, my brother and my sister. And so the kingdom was restored when Christ Jesus came preaching, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The Bible is indeed all about the custody of the control, rulership, and government of the kingdom on the earth. You know, Micah prophesied about God's vision for mankind. Here it is in Micah chapter 4, verse 8. Micah says, and thou, O tower of the flock, the stronghold of the daughter of Zion. Look at what the Bible says. Unto thee shall it come, even the first dominion. unto you, my brother and my sister, shall come the first dominion. The kingdom shall come to the daughter of Jerusalem. It is God's will that we exercise the first dominion, which was originally exercised by Adam and Eve. God wants this first dominion to be restored in his people. In fact, he has already made it available to us, but unfortunately, because we are not hearing about the gospel of the kingdom, we do not understand that the first dominion has been restored to us, my brother and my sister. This could only be made possible if the enemy was defeated, if his goods were spoiled, my brother and my sister, if he was destroyed, if his works were destroyed, so that God's kingdom could be restored on the earth, so that man's dominion mandate could be restored on the earth. Christ Jesus, when he was on the cross, declared, "It is finished," my brother and my sister. Christ Jesus made it possible for you to experience and exercise the first dominion. Now, because God gave man dominion over the earth realm, Satan's promotion to the seat of authority resulted in man's demotion or removal from that seat of authority. But here's good news. Romans chapter 11, verse 29. The Bible says, "For the gifts and calling of God are without repentance." Remember, God said, "Let us make man and let them have dominion." And so dominion was a gift from God, my brother and my sister. The Bible says the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. This is the King James Version of this scripture. Here's what the New King James Version says. It says, this is Romans 11, 29, New King James Version. "For the gifts and calling of God are irrevocable." And so Christ Jesus and Holy Spirit spoiled principalities and powers and destroyed, judged, and cast out that devil and destroyed his works, my brother and my sister. Because the Bible says that the gifts and calling of God are irrevocable, the devil's defeat meant man's restoration to his position of sonship, dominion, and authority. If he accepted God's plan of salvation and came under God's kingdom government again. I'll say that again. Because the gifts and calling of God are irrevocable, the devil's defeat meant man's restoration to his position of sonship, dominion, and authority. If he accepted God's plan of salvation and brought himself again under God's kingdom government. Now, because the enemy had taken dominion in this region, Christ Jesus also had to come and defeat him in this region. Remember what God told the devil, represented by the serpent in the Garden of Eden. Here it is in Genesis 3:15. He says, "And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed, and it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel." Remember, we also said that the word head was the Hebrew word roshe. That's R-O-S-H, which means place, rank, highest part, top, forefront position, and principal ruler. But here's what Christ Jesus said to the 70 when they returned from their mission, just rejoicing. Here it is in Luke chapter 10, verses 17 to 18. "And the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name." Look at what Jesus says in Luke 10, 18. "And he said unto them, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven." My brother and my sister, this was the seed that came to remove him from his rank, from his top, from his highest part, from his rulership position. What does this word heaven mean? Jesus says, "I beheld Satan as lightning." That's a quick move, my brother and my sister. Fall from heaven. This word heaven is the Greek word ouranos. O-U-R-A-N-O-S. Look at what Jesus was saying. This word heaven is ouranos, which means elevated position and seat of authority, my brother and my sister. Jesus say, "I beheld Satan as lightning fall from his elevated position, fall from his seat of authority, fall from his power." My brother and my sister, as a child of God, as God's son, as a citizen of his kingdom, and as his ambassador, that devil has been defeated. You have power and authority. Christ Jesus has stripped him from all authority over you. He no longer has jurisdiction over you. You are now under God's government, and you now have diplomatic immunity as God's ambassador, my brother and my sister. This is the seed of the woman bruising the serpent's head and removing him from the position of authority he stole as promised by God in the Garden of Eden. What did we say were the two primary things that man lost through disobedience in the garden? We said that man lost his dominion assignment or his dominion mandate, and he also lost his kingdom citizenship, which was connected to his sonship. So here's what Jesus said to the 70 after he beheld Satan fall from his seat of authority. Here it is in Luke chapter 10, verses 19 to 20. Jesus told those 70, my brother and my sister, and you and I by extension. He says, behold, hey, Yena, take note of this. I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions, and power over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you, my brother and my sister. You will remember that in Genesis 3:15, God was speaking to the devil and the serpent, advising that one day the woman's seed was going to bruise his head. But here it is, Jesus is saying, I give you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Now Jesus is saying that he had released power to tread on, to have authority over serpents and scorpions. This was fulfillment of a prophecy, my brother and my sister. But remember, we saw that man lost his dominion mandate and his kingdom citizenship, which was connected to his sonship. When Jesus gave us power and authority over all the power of the enemy and told us that we are empowered to tread on or exercise dominion over all the power of the enemy and serpents and scorpions, Christ Jesus was restoring man's dominion mandate or his dominion assignment, my brother and my sister. Jesus continued his conversation with the 70 in verse 20 of Luke 10. He says, notwithstanding in this, rejoice not that the spirits are subject unto thee, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven, my brother and my sister. When you are born again, your sonship and your citizenship in God's kingdom were immediately restored and duly recorded and registered in heaven, my brother and my sister. This was restoration of man's kingdom citizenship and man's sonship. Jesus says your names are written in heaven. This does not just mean that you're going to go to heaven one day in the sweet by and sing with the angels in your mansion when you die. Jesus says your names are registered in heaven right now. Right now you are a citizen of God's kingdom. Right now you are a son of God, my brother and my sister. This restoration of man's kingdom citizenship and man's sonship. Here's what John says about your sonship upon your rebirth. St. John chapter 1, verses 12 to 13. The Bible says, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Christ Jesus came to defeat that devil so that your sonship, citizenship, and your rulership or ambassadorship can be restored. Here it is in verse 13 of St. John's 1, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. Remember, we learned that when Adam and Eve were driven out of the garden, remember we saw last week that they were gorash, they were driven out, they were divorced, they were expatriated out of the kingdom of God or the kingdom of light, and they were expatriated into the kingdom of darkness. They were our forefathers, and they represented each and every one of us. And so for this reason, each and every one of us were born into the kingdom of darkness, my brother and my sister. But here's what Paul the Apostle says that Christ Jesus came to do. Colossians chapter 1, verses 12 to 13. The Bible says, giving thanks unto the Father, which had made us meet. He has qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. Look at verse 13. The Bible says, who hath delivered us from the power. That's the authority. That's the kingdom. That's the jurisdiction. That's the influence of darkness. And he has translated us into the kingdom of God's dear Son, my brother and my sister. Christ Jesus made it possible for every man who accepts his plan of salvation through faith to be delivered from the kingdom of darkness and to be repatriated as fully naturalized citizens of God's heavenly kingdom. My brother and my sister, the first kingdom of heaven was established in the Garden of Eden. Jesus' mission was to reestablish the kingdom of heaven, but this time in the hearts of men. This is why Jesus said what he said to the Pharisees in Luke 17. Here it is in Luke 17, 20 to 21. The Bible says in verse 20, and when he was demanded of the Pharisees when the kingdom of God should come, he answered them and said, the kingdom of God cometh not with observation. Here it is in verse 21. Neither shall they say, lo here or lo there, for behold, the kingdom of God is within you. And so the first kingdom is in the Garden of Eden, but Jesus came to establish a kingdom in the hearts of man. According to Jeremiah, he came to write his laws on our hearts and on our minds, my brother and my sister, so that God's government can be established on the inside of us. Dr. Miles Monroe helps us to understand what happened to us when we became born again in his book called Preparing for Kingdom Experience and Expansion. Here's what Dr. Monroe says, my brother and my sister. He says, when we are born again or we become citizens of God's kingdom, it means that we voluntarily align ourselves with a new government and a new country, embracing its language, its ideals, and its values. I'll say that again. When we are born again or become citizens of God's kingdom, it means that we voluntarily align ourselves with a new government and a new country, embracing its language, its ideals, and its values. So here's what happened to you in the spirit realm when you accepted God's plan of salvation, my brother and my sister. You lowered the flag of the kingdom of Satan or the kingdom of darkness, and you raised the flag of the kingdom of God or the kingdom of light over your life again. And so because we gave our hearts to God and we became his sons and citizens of his kingdom, his original governmental structure and divine order has been restored in our individual lives. Now as the saints of God, the legitimate government of our lives was restored. And so remember, we saw that this was the governmental order in the beginning. Jesus Christ is our Lord. God is our King and our Master and our ruler. And so we have now again been brought under God's government. And so we are now again empowered to exercise dominion and authority under God's delegated authority, my brother and my sister, on this earth. The devil was not designed to exercise dominion on this earth. He is illegitimate. God has given man dominion on this earth. But only those who accept his plan of salvation are able to exercise this dominion, my brother and my sister. God is now our king again. And guess what? Because of the cleansing power of the blood of Jesus, my brother and my sister, those of us who accepted God's plan of salvation again qualify as suitable residences for the royal governor from heaven. And so guess what happened? The governor returned, my brother, my sister. The royal governor returned on the day of Pentecost. This was the Holy Ghost who came back. Remember, he was recalled to the imperial power after man declared independence. But now, because the kingdom of God has been reestablished on the earth, God released the royal governor back again to dwell on the inside of us, my brother and my sister. What happened on the day of Pentecost? They began to speak with tongues. Tongues is not a religious experience, but it's a kingdom experience, my brother and my sister. We in the Bahamas speak the king's or the queen's English because we were previously colonized by Great Britain. The people in Cuba speak Spanish because they were colonized by Spain. The people of Brazil speak Portuguese because they were colonized by Portugal. And so what happened is the brothers and sisters, the apostles, on the day of Pentecost spoke with tongues to confirm their reconnection with the imperial power of heaven. The speaking of tongues confirmed that the imperial power colony relationship had been reestablished in their lives, my brother and my sister. Because of the governor's return, we now have the ability to reflect kingdom culture and to demonstrate kingdom power and authority, my brother and my sister. The ability to speak in tongues is just confirmation of our reconnection with our imperial power and the government of heaven. You know, Daniel prophesied about this dispensation when the saints would again possess the kingdom. Here it is in Daniel chapter 7, verses 21 to 22. The Bible says in verse 21, I beheld, and the same horn made war with the saints and prevailed against them. Look at what the Bible says in verse 22 of Daniel 7. They prevailed against them until the Ancient of Days came and judgment was given to the saints of the Most High, and the time came that the saints possessed the kingdom. My brother and my sister, the enemy is still prevailing over some of God's people because they do not realize that the time has come and they now possess the kingdom of God. Here's Daniel again in Daniel 7 and 18. But the saints of the Most High shall take the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever, even forever. Here's Daniel one last time in Daniel 7:27. And the kingdom and dominion and the greatness of the kingdom under the whole heaven shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High, whose kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominion shall serve and obey him. My brother and my sister, Christ Jesus is Lord and owner and possessor of the kingdom, but he made the kingdom available to the people of God. This was the first dominion that Micah spoke about in Micah chapter 4, verse 8, my brother and my sister. In the first words of Jesus' greatest recorded sermon, that's the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus spoke of the ownership of the kingdom by those who acknowledge their spiritual bankruptcy and poverty. Here it is in Matthew 5 and 3. Jesus says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Jesus says, listen, if you acknowledge your spiritual bankruptcy and poverty and trust in him for salvation and redemption, he says you are owner of the kingdom. He says, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Paul the Apostle lets us know that when we were born again, we did not receive religion. Here's what Paul says we received in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 28. Wherefore, we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved. Let us have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. My brother and my sister, we received a kingdom, not religion. This was what Christ Jesus came to restore and reestablish that which was lost, which was God's kingdom government on the earth. This was God's plan all along. Reestablishment of the kingdom of God on the earth and return of the kingdom and position of dominion to mankind. This is why Jesus lets us know that he was our example and our model, and that the same dominion and authority that he demonstrated while on the earth is available to the people of God. This is what he meant when he said a thing to his disciples and by extension us. Look at this in Luke chapter 22, verse 29. Jesus says, "And I appoint unto you a kingdom as my Father had appointed unto me." Christ Jesus gave us our official credentials or our letters of appointments as his ambassadors, my brother and my sister. He appointed unto us a kingdom with the same power and authority and influence that his Father appointed him, my brother and my sister. Paul the Apostle lets us know that we received our letters of credence, our letters of appointment. Here it is in 2 Corinthians 5 and 20. Paul says, "Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God." My brother and my sister, religions do not have ambassadors. Kingdoms have ambassadors, and the Bible says that we are now ambassadors for Christ, my brother and my sister. We are God's salt and light and leaven, and our mission is therefore to influence this territory for our God and his kingdom, not just to prepare to die and go to heaven and sing with the angels in the sweet by and by, which we are being told in the church today. And so because of the finished work of Calvary, the custody of the kingdom was restored to mankind. This is a graphic representation of the same. He said that the kingdom began with God. It was transferred to mankind. Through rebellion, mankind transferred the kingdom to Satan. Christ Jesus received the kingdom strategically from his Father when the Word became flesh. And by virtue of Jesus' defeat of that devil, Jesus Christ has restored the kingdom to mankind. My brother and my sister, there's one more transfer of the custody that has not happened as yet. As we know, the devil is still the god of this world, and he has only lost authority over the lives of the people of God that accept God's plan of salvation. One of these days, however, his power will be totally eradicated and eliminated from the earth. This is the final phase of the custody of the kingdom. Here's what the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15, 24. Paul says, "Then cometh the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom to God." He's talking about Christ Jesus now. "Then cometh the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and all power." These words "put down" are that same word katageo that we saw a little earlier. And so the kingdom will be delivered up to God when the devil's rule and influence and culture and the culture of the kingdom of darkness is fully eradicated from the earth. This is when the devil and the beast and the false prophet will be cast into the lake of fire to be tormented day and night forever. According to Revelation chapter 20 and verse 10, here's what John the Revelator says in Revelation chapter 12, verse 10. John says, "And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night." Complete salvation and the full restoration of the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ will only come when the accuser of the brethren is cast down and completely destroyed. But until then, my brother and my sister, the power and authority of that devil and the kingdom of darkness have been broken from off your life. You are now able to exercise kingdom power and authority, the power and authority of the kingdom of light and the kingdom of God, my brother and my sister. Remember what the devil said when he was tempting Jesus. Here it is in Luke chapter 4, verses 5 to 6. The Bible says, and the devil, taking him up unto an high mountain, shewed unto him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. The devil showed Jesus the kingdoms of the world. I don't want you to miss that. Then he confirmed their conveyance and transfer to him. Here it is in verse 6. And the devil said unto him, all this power will I give thee, and the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me, and to whomsoever I will I give it. The devil, even though he was the father of lies, was here telling the truth, because Adam and Eve did indeed transfer and deliver up the kingdom to him. But here's what the Bible says will happen to that devil at the end of the age, when the accuser of the brethren is cast down, when all rule and authority and power that God did not establish are eliminated and eradicated from the earth. Here's what the great voices in heaven will declare when the enemy is fully bound and defeated. Here it is in Revelation chapter 11, verse 15. And the seventh angel sounded, and there were great voices in heaven. Remember, the devil showed Jesus the kingdoms of this world. But here are what those great voices will say. The kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever, my brother and my sister. That devil has his day coming when all of his rule and authority and his power are cast down, and the kingdoms of this world will become the kingdoms of our God and of his Christ. And so at the end of the age, with full restoration of the kingdom to God, the custody of the kingdom will be completed. We said that the kingdom began with God. It was transferred to mankind. Mankind rebelled and disobeyed God, transferred it to Satan. The word was made flesh. Christ Jesus came down, defeated that devil. As a result of Jesus' defeat of the devil, the kingdom was restored to mankind. And we just saw that at the end of the age, the kingdom will be restored to God. This, my brother and my sister, is the story of the Bible in a nutshell. This is the custody of the kingdom. This is the core story of the Bible. But that fifth transfer back to God has not happened as yet. And so this is where we are in God's timetable. This is the dispensation where the people of God are the possessors of the kingdom. Unfortunately, the majority of God's people are not hearing the gospel of the kingdom, and they are not aware that they are now possessors of the kingdom with all the rights, benefits, privileges, power, and authority that relate to that prestigious position. Again, I say, unfortunately, because the majority of God's people are not hearing the gospel of the kingdom, they are not aware that they are now possessors of the kingdom with all the rights, benefits, privileges, power, and authority that relate to this kingdom. Many of us are therefore not as victorious as we could be and as we should be. Here's another quote from Dr. Miles Monroe's book called Preparing for Kingdom Experience and Expansion. Dr. Monroe says, as citizens of heaven, we inhabit the earth for the purpose of influencing it with the culture and values of heaven and bringing it under the government of the King of Heaven. I say it again, as citizens of heaven, we inhabit the earth for the purpose of influencing it with the culture and values of heaven and bringing it under the government of the King of Heaven. This explains why Jesus instructed us to pray in Matthew 6 and 10, Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Notice we should pray for more of his kingdom to come so that more of his will, desires, purpose, and intent could be done on the earth as it is in heaven. The focus of today's church is for the people of God to go to heaven. But God wants more of the influence and power and authority and the overall culture of his kingdom to be manifested on the earth. I say again, the focus of today's church is for the people of God to go to heaven. But God wants more of the influence, power, authority, and the overall culture of his kingdom to be manifested on the earth. This is why Jesus prayed the way he did in St. John 17, 15. He says, I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them from the evil. My brother and my sister, the church, we're telling people we got to go and get excited and go to heaven. Jesus said, don't take my salt and light and leaven out of the earth. I need them here to influence this jurisdiction for my kingdom. I need more of my kingdom to be expanded in the earth. I need my light to be here to influence the kingdom of darkness that still prevails on the earth in the lives of those who have not yet accepted God's plan of salvation. Now we understand why we said that our God's highest priority is the reestablishment of his kingdom on the earth. This is why God sent his son. This is why Jesus Christ came and his disciples and apostles were so kingdom focused. This is why we as his body need to be more kingdom focused. We need to take his yoke upon us and begin to align ourselves with God's purpose, plan, and intent. Reestablishment of his kingdom on the earth. This is what God desired most of all. I pray that you now have a better understanding of the kingdom of God. Praise the name of Jesus. We give God thanks and praise for this wonderful night. We thank him for his word. Let's just bow in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Lord, we give you thanks, we give you praise, we give you glory and honor, Lord God. Lord God, we just appreciate you right now for all that you continue to reveal to us, Lord God. We thank you for the light and the life, Lord God, that you continue to expose us to, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. For this reason, Lord God, we will not abide in darkness, Lord God, but we shall have the light of life, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, Lord God, for this word tonight. We thank you, Lord God, that your people are being leavened, Lord God, from the inside out. We thank you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ, that strength and might, Lord God, and power and authority, Lord God, are being provided and infused into your people. We thank you, Lord God, that the people of God are being strengthened with all might in the inner man, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, because your word declares that the kingdom of heaven is like unto leaven, which a woman took and hid, Father God, in 3 measures of meal until all was leavened. And so, Lord God, we declare by faith that the people of God are being leavened by the word of God. We thank you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, that this word has found good ground in the hearts of your people. We declare by faith, O God, that it shall bring forth 100-fold in the lives of your people. We bless you, Lord God, that you're pulling us out of religion, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, and causing us, Lord God, to be more kingdom-minded, Lord God, to realize, oh God, that we have power and authority, to realize, oh God, that that devil, Father God, has been destroyed, and his works have been destroyed, and if we submit ourselves to you and resist that devil, the word of God declares that he will, Father God, flee from us. Father, we give you thanks. We give you praise. We thank you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, for kingdom, power, and authority. We thank you, Lord God, that you gave us our letters of appointment, our letters of credence, Lord God. You appointed unto us a kingdom, even as, Father God, in the name of Jesus, you appointed Christ Jesus a kingdom. Father, we thank you that the love wherewith you had for Christ Jesus, you also have for us. He was the first begotten, Lord God. We are now your sons, Lord God, your citizens, your ambassadors, Father God. Lord God, those to whom you have restored dominion, Father God, and authority on the earth. Father God, we give you thanks, we give you praise, we give you glory and honor, might and dominion and power, Lord God, even now, Father God, in the name of Jesus. Father, perhaps someone is listening who don't know you in the pardon of their sins. As we pray always, Lord God, we pray that you turn their hearts toward you. Father God, even now, Father God, as your plenipotentiaries, as your envoys, your ambassadors, Lord God, and your diplomats, we declare, oh God, Father God, that they are set free. We declare, oh God, that their hearts are turned toward you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord God, that the power of the kingdom of darkness is broken, Father God, of everyone listening who might not know you in the pardon of their sins. We stand, Father God, in the name of Jesus with kingdom, power, and authority. Father God, even now, perhaps, Father God, someone is listening, and Father God, perhaps they are ailing in their bodies. Perhaps there's some sickness, some disease in their bodies or their minds, my Father God, in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord God, that your word declares how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him, according to Acts 10:38. Father God, we thank you, Lord God, that you have destroyed, Father God, the works of the kingdom of darkness, which includes sickness and disease and depression and lack and death and depth and everything else, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord God, for you have luo the works of the kingdom of darkness and the works of the devil. And so, Father, we thank you that the spirit of infirmity and sickness even now are broken from off your people. We come against, Lord God, and touch and agree against that spirit of cancer, Lord God, that's driving through the land and driving through the world, my Father. It's a principality, and we pull down that demon even now because it continues to impact too many people. And so, Father, we stand as your ambassadors, your envoys, your diplomats, Father God, your plenipotentiary, and we bind that spirit of cancer from out this land, and we drive it from the bodies of your people. Father God, you've given us power. You've given us authority. And we stand on that authority tonight, understanding that there's no distance in the spirit realm, my Father. Father, we give you thanks, fellow. Father God, we bless you, Lord God, for restoring, Father God, the imperial power colony relationship, Lord God. And thus, Father God, we're able to speak the language of our imperial power, which is heaven, Father God. And speak mystery. And Father, we give you thanks, Lord God, because, Lord God, this gospel of the kingdom is being preached in all the world. We thank you, Lord God, for you said, Lord God, the end will only come when we, Father God, as your people, preach this gospel of the kingdom in all the earth, Lord God. We thank you, Lord, that we're doing our little part to get this gospel out to the world. Father, we give you thanks for this wonderful, wonderful evening. We thank you, Lord God, that the saints of God are being strengthened. Lord God, and the Tarabako Sheki Tabasantibi, Noblevesi and Tobasa. Father, we can Sotianto, Nisebo Shenibaso. Be free in the name of Jesus. Be whole in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Be set free in the name of the Yosike Shetibanto. Mirisharabanto Rabakashakamanto. Healing and wholeness and deliverance. Peace of mind, Iki Sheken Dolmakasha Kantyantarabasa, Nesebashko. We drive out every demon spirit from Nikeshi and Tabasokibanto. Nikara Shorabadabe. The kingdom of God has come unto you. 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 The kingdom of God has come. Mosiri Antorabakashaka Yandarabasa. The culture of the kingdom is manifested even now in your life to bring healing and deliverance. To bring love, to bring forgiveness, to bring peace, to bring joy. Father, we give you thanks. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Thy kingdom come. In Jesus' name, amen.
You've been listening to a message by Pastor Aziel McFaul, Kingdom citizen and ambassador of Christ. We trust that this message has been a blessing to you and that in some small way it has helped you to become more knowledgeable about God's kingdom and His righteousness. It is our prayer that God grants you a heart that hungers and thirsts after His kingdom and His righteousness so that you will be filled or supplied and begin to experience the abundant life that Christ Jesus came to make available to His children. If you desire further information about our ministry or access to additional resources, please feel free to contact Pastor McFaul at 242-427-5512 or internationally at 954-284-7909. Dare to take God at His word. Seek His kingdom and His righteousness. Be delivered from the spirit of religion and begin to live life on another level. God bless you is our prayer.
Let the kings worship Him today. Let the kings worship Him.
Greetings in the name of our